Well, we're so glad you're back with us today at GoldSeek.com Radio for another Gold Nugget segment with Dr. Stephen Lieb, best-selling author of Red Alert. Well, it's a pleasure to have Dr. Stephen Lieb back on the show. The latest of his 7 bestsellers includes Red Alert.
That's true.
Well, I understand the weather in New York today is actually improving. It's getting a bit warmer on the East Coast.
Weather in New York is beautiful.
I thought we could begin the dialogue today, if we could, with the precious metals market. It's our listeners' favorite. Now, after recording one of the most impressive rallies in years, the metals have cooled off in the past few weeks. And what I find interesting is that the U.S. dollar, though, well, it's missed every opportunity that it's had to move sharply higher. Why do you think the greenback is having trouble finding momentum here? And what could that mean for the commodities, the CRB index, and the precious metals?
Well, I actually think that one signal for the metals and precious metals in particular to rally will probably be more aggressive steps taken by the European Union to get their economies going. And I do think you'll see a dollar rally, and I think you'll probably see gold rally on the back of that dollar, believe it or not. I mean, I think the dollar-gold connection is, you know, somewhat overrated. It may work out almost the opposite this time around, in which you have a relatively strong dollar and strong gold at the same time. And the reason being, once the Europeans start, aggressively easing monetary policy, you're going to get a lot of growth. And I think you're going to stimulate a lot of demand for commodities. If you go back, Chris, to the commodity charts, you find that most, or at least a lot of the indices, it really didn't make peaks in 2008, but they made peaks in 2011. And that was almost to the month when the European countries went into a funk. They had 6 consecutive quarters of negative growth, and commodities came down. And the Eurozone is the world's most important and largest economic bloc. I think that what's happened in the Ukraine is kind of a sidebar to the implications. And you know, one of many, many implications is that the European Central Bank has to be very, very careful that these peripheral countries maintain strong growth. Or else, you know, they could drift eastward themselves, especially the Baltic countries, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia. They have to be very, very careful, and I think that's really been a sort of set a fire under them to start stimulating their own economies, and I think you'll see metals lift with that, precious metals in particular. I mean, they tend to, you know, follow commodities. And eventually, As is always the case, you probably have a little bit too much of a good thing. And I think that that will lead to, you know, a major rally in gold.
You've made that interesting correlation with the euro. You said something to the effect that, you know, we're looking at about 500 million people there as opposed to the United States, roughly 300 million. I mean, it truly is an economic engine to be contended with. So we're thinking of China, looking at them for all the growth, but we can't ignore Europe.
No, you can, and you know, per capita income, et cetera. Europe is a considerably larger economy than China, and when it goes into a funk, I mean, it really was, you know, kind of a historic post-war funk, 6 consecutive quarters of decline. It's going to take its toll, and it certainly has taken its toll. But I mean, you know, over the past few weeks, when you've heard talk of a more aggressive monetary stance among the European countries, especially the Bundesbank going along with quantitative easing, I mean, that's like cows recommending steak for dinner. It's a strong sign that they mean business. They really know that they've got to go after economic growth, or else they could face very, very serious consequences.
And I wonder if you might address one of your recent calls for the yellow metal of 2,000 to 2,500. $100 that we could actually see, at least on a nominal basis, higher levels with gold. I mean, we've really experienced quite a reaction here, and it seems like we've put in a floor, at least for the time being. You expect the typical forces that were in play back in the early 2000s to support the precious metals here, and then a resurgence of economic growth in Europe. Are you concerned at all about some sluggish economic reports coming from China?
No, I'm not really that concerned. I mean, obviously, you know, you've got an economy as large and complex as China. There are going to be a lot of cross currents there, especially as they kind of transition from a export-driven to a consumer-driven economy. But they have massive infrastructure spending ahead of them that's going to make a lot of sense for them to do, especially in terms of building up a energy infrastructure that I think they want to build, and they would hope will last them for the next, 100 years. I think they're well ahead of us and well ahead of almost everybody else in terms of doing that, with the possible exception of Germany. I mean, they've also done a lot of work in building renewable energies, et cetera. But China, I mean, they're going to be spending, I mean, north of $1 trillion over the next 4, 5, 6 years, well north of $1 trillion, putting up a smart grid and putting in renewable energies and getting set for this century. And that, I think, will sustain growth in that country for a long time to come.
Well, I wanted to ask you about this trend we've seen in China regarding physical gold. You know, we've had quite a shift from a prohibition on gold ownership to overtly encouraging ownership. You've gone on record recently saying that officials are laying the groundwork potentially for a gold-backed currency. Any comments?
Yeah, I think for sure. I think that, you know, right now, you know, I think the dynamics in the world, the economic dynamics in the world are really shifting, and they're shifting east. You know, probably away from our country and much, much more toward China, Russia, to some extent, and Germany. You know, what was kind of lost in this recent, Ukraine disaster or whatever. I mean, you know, don't want to say anything good about Putin because there's nothing really good to say about him. But, you know, nevertheless, he's, you know, taken advantage of a certain economic levers that he has, and you know, one of them is that his railway, Germany's railway, their partners, basically transport a lot of goods between Germany and China, and the amount of goods are increasing and increasing rapidly, and you know, this is a very, very big block. I mean, China, Russia, Germany, etc. And you consider their proximity to the Middle East, there are a lot of edges that they have. And I think that they, you know, eventually envision a day in which there will be a basket of currencies, and it will include or have, quite a bit of gold in it, and not too many dollars. And I think that that's basically the way the world is shifting at this point. I think, you know, I don't know how many years down the road, but a few, maybe. I don't think you'll see oil priced in dollars anymore. I think you'll see it priced in terms of a basket of currencies, of which, you know, gold will certainly, and gold, and the yuan. And I think some of these currencies, you know, I don't know whether it'll follow Bretton Woods exactly, but I mean, some of these currencies might be directly convertible into gold, like the yuan. Like even maybe the German mark standing alone. I don't know. I mean, I have no idea exactly how it plays out, but it does seem the world is shifting from west to east. You will have a new standard, a new type of world currency, and the dollar will play a very small role, or a much, much, much smaller role in that than it does today.
It's interesting. And, you know, we've seen quite a bit of support under West Texas Intermediate crude in recent years and even recently. It's interesting to note that it has essentially treaded water in a very broad consolidation now for, it seems like, almost 5 years. It looks as though the crude oil market is waiting for some impetus to send it substantially higher. Do you concur, or do you see something else happening there?
I do concur. I think oil prices could go dramatically higher, but I don't know whether it's going to happen in 3 months or 30 months. But I think that the U.S. has made, I think, really a fatal bet on fracking. And it's, you know, it could last another, you know, couple of years. I mean, we could continue to increase oil production, but then it stops. I mean, there's only so much productivity you can get out of every rig. Once that productivity starts leveling off, you just need more and more rigs because the decline rates are so high that it just doesn't become feasible, doesn't become cost-effective. In fact, you know, you can always get oil out of the ground, but it may start costing, you know, $150, $200, who knows how much. And that will be a very bad sign. And that could be not only a reason for oil to go a lot higher, but that could be the catalyst that causes us to shift off the dollar as a way of pricing oil. I mean, that I think would be very, very important. I mean, this country has really, I think, almost bet the farm on, you know, energy independence vis-a-vis fracking. And I just don't see that working out. I hope I'm dead wrong on this, incidentally. I hope I'm completely wrong on it. But I just, you know, I fear, because I think that the logic behind it just doesn't suggest a long-term solution for this at all. Doesn't suggest it is a long-term solution to our energy problems, our energy needs. It just doesn't. So I think that's what I would keep an eye on, and I think that probably will be the most important catalyst that you'll see over the next several years, decline in production rates of oil in this country. Now, again, I can't say whether that's going to happen, start happening in 3 or 6 or 30 months, but it will happen in the not-too-distant future.
That is certainly not good news for the United States, but it's, I guess, music to the ears of fans of photovoltaics. What an interesting tie-in, because I know you're a huge fan, as am I. We've discussed in the past many times solar panels and their amazing qualities and the way that they've increased efficiency in recent years. And we've also talked about the fact that just a 100-watt solar panel can require up to an ounce of silver to manufacture. What a hot sector. You know, at one point in recent months, solar-related companies, First Solar and others, were the hottest sector. I think I read somewhere at BigCharts.com that there was nearly a 1,000% increase.
Solar is growing very rapidly, and, you know, some of the manufacturers of photovoltaics are growing, too, are doing very, very well in the market, like Giga Solar, which is a Taiwanese company that I follow. And silver itself, though, has been kind of dead in the water, which I just find, I'd be very, very honest, I find it very puzzling. I don't like to, you know, talk about conspiracy or you know, things being held down, et cetera. But if I were to bet that there was something going on in one particular market right now, it would probably be silver. I have no idea why it's still trading near $20. I mean, I honestly think it should be closer to $35, $40, $50, $60. Much, much higher prices. You know, there have been these rumors in the silver market for years and years that it's being manipulated. I don't place that much credence in it, but it certainly seems odd in the face of, you know, the performance of stocks, again, like Giga Solar. I mean, unfortunately, you can't buy it in this country. You have to, you know, you have to be able to speak, I guess it is, what, Mandarin or Cantonese, and live in Taiwan. You know, if you look at it, it's certainly belies a dead silver market. I mean, it really is a stock dedicated to photovoltaics and silver paste in particular, and the stock has gone gangbusters. And its earnings have gone gangbusters. And historically, silver had followed this stock pretty faithfully, and it kind of stopped. So it sort of, in fact, I'm just punching up the stock now, Chris. And, you know, it stock has gone from, 300 to 700 in the year to date. Yeah, and, you know, you see things that are, like, you know, pretty obvious. I mean, just, you know, quoting the description of the company. Giga Solar Materials manufactures solar conductive paste to provide solar energy. So it's difficult to connect the dots when you see a company, you know, which is fairly substantial, up, way up, you know, doubling in not too long a period of time. Yet what they're, you know, relying on as raw product, you know, basically just staying, you know, fit and just staying, you know, just sitting still. I think silver will have its day. That's the bottom line. And I think when it does, it'll be explosive. It really, really will take off. It'll be a, you know, gangbusters. Now, you know, one reason could be copper. Copper's kind of been a laggard and might be a laggard this year because, I've, you know, there's a little bit of excess copper production, and that might run into 2016 or so. But I just don't see any excess silver production at all, and I have no reason. I just don't have an explanation.
The problem might lead to the solution. The very fact that people are relegating silver to the industrial metal category could bode well for its future prospects.
Yeah, no, it absolutely could. And like I said, these things tend to straighten themselves out. And I think you will have like a, I think you'll have a massive rally in silver. I really do.
One of my picks, First Solar, recommended it right around 35 to 37. It's a horse race. You're a nose ahead of me here. 37, and it's about 73 now, so probably not quite 100% that you have. But you know what? I think this company, FSLR, is on the verge of a breakout. Please, folks, don't take that as a recommendation. It's just a fantastic company. Great fundamentals. Financials are really sound, and the technicals are great. I want to see this company north of 100, something to put on people's radar screen. Also wanted to ask you about the rare earth elements. This is another area that you've been watching closely, one of the few people to do so. I want to give the listeners an idea of just how essential these are. I mean, it's in virtually just like silver, but we see it in everything from hard drives on your desktop and your laptop. If you ever need a rare earth magnet, you have some of those outdated hard drives sitting around, crack one open, you'll have a wonderfully powerful magnet for free. Wind turbines, another, and hydraulic turbines. So these are very hot, just like solar panels. You need rare earths to produce high quality turbines.
I think that what you say is absolutely true. Basically, I guess from the 50s on, every decade you saw a quantum leap in permanent magnets and their power. And then all that stopped with the advent of rare earths around mid-1980s, and we really haven't made any real progress in developing stronger magnets since, I don't know, mid-late 1980s. And even the research that you see today on some of the nanotechnologies still focus on rare earths, because it's rare earths that have been at the center of high-level magnetism and permanent magnets. And there's a lot you cannot do without permanent magnets, and you name some of them. A lot of electronic equipment relies on them. A lot of very advanced defense equipment relies on rare earths. Right now, we don't have any real of the important rare earths. We don't have, we basically don't have any supply. I mean, we have one major rare earth company that's operating, that's Molycorp, but they don't produce the kind of rare earths you need for magnets, which are the heavy rare earths. And we don't have the supply chain from getting the ore out of the ground, rare earth ore out of the ground, to actually producing a permanent magnet. I mean, there's probably 6 to 10 steps in that chain. And the only country that, you know, really can do it right now is China. I mean, not only are they the biggest supplier of rare earth ore, they are also the only country that has an absolute soup-to-nuts supply chain for producing rare earths. It's another, you know, area where we've really got to get on our horse and start moving fast. There are other rare earth deposits out there, heavy rare earth deposits, but the point is that there hasn't been any real effort to put up, you know, the other parts of the supply chain you're going to need in order to get from those rare earths to those heavy rare earths to permanent magnets. I mean, that's a very, very technical, refined process, and it takes a lot of education, a lot of technique. And we don't produce the engineers in this country right now, at least we're not producing them, that have that capability. And, you know, that's why, you know, Molycorp has to ship their ore off to China in order to have it processed. And if these other companies like Ucor, et cetera, which we've talked about and recommended, that they've done very, very well, but they're also going to need access to all these other processing, refining, separation. I mean, all the things that go into, you know, getting heavy rare earths, they don't have it. They may rely on China, too, which is, it's just not a good position to be in. I mean, we should be in a position where we really control our own fate, especially in an area as vital as this. And, you know, the irony here, Chris, is that, you know, the new technologies that you see surrounding rare earths and the efforts to come up with other forms of permanent magnets rely on rare earths. And, you know, you use nanotechnologies, okay, that's fine. But, you know, what percent of the weight of the magnet are there? What percent of the nanoparticles are rare earth? And a lot. I mean, there just doesn't appear to be any way around our need for these heavy rare earths. And, you know, I'm not saying that it's a hopeless situation, but it's something that just doesn't seem to be on our radar screen right now. And we should put it there very, very high up.
Agreed. And I hope that some sharp listener comes up with a way, devises a method for recycling rare earths, because they're becoming, you know, much more prevalent in our items today.
They really are. And I think anything we can do to improve or facilitate their availability would just be great. It would just be doing this country a tremendous service.
A possible way to benefit your country as well as profit for your family as well. So
absolutely, absolutely, yes.
Everybody wins. Well, as we wrap up today, is there anything else on your radar screen that you'd like to share with the listeners?
I would keep a very careful eye on what's going on with the Iranian nuclear talks. I think they're, you know, more than important right now. I think that there has been a sense is that Saudi Arabia is very upset with the United States, and I think that that's a major concern. It really is. And I think that we have to be extremely careful how we handle these talks. I think we have to be extremely careful what role Russia is going to start playing in the world. And we have to continue to remind ourselves that Russia and China are neighbors. They have like $500 billion energy pact right now. That's a lot of money. They have a lot of mutual interests in common. Those mutual interests really don't include us other than as a peripheral player. So, yeah, there's a lot to watch. There really is right now an awful lot to watch. I do think that we have to watch what's going on in the East and the Middle East. It's going to be very, very easy to lose control of these situations. I really do. I mean, I can envision, I'm not saying I'm predicting this, but I certainly can envision a situation in which Iran has control of the, not control, but has basic control over the Iranian nuclear facilities. By virtue of that, has a lot of sway over in Saudi Arabia, and Russia does. I mean, Russia has control over Iranian nuclear facilities, which gives them a lot of sway in Saudi Arabia, China a lot of sway in Saudi Arabia. These are the kind of dynamics that make for a change in reserve currency status. I mean, all the Saudis have to do, I mean, despite everything that we've seen, is say that they want to price their oil in something other than dollars, and then the world shifts. It's like a, you know, like an earthquake, a monetary earthquake, and that could happen. And it's, you know, I really would keep your eye on the headlines on the front pages as well as what you see on the internet on the financial pages. It's a German alliance too. I mean, you know, what struck me. And I did write a little bit about it, was when, you know, the Ukraine thing first broke out, the president of China, Xi, had paid a visit to Germany, and he was in Duisburg, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but, you know, that's a city that houses the largest land-based port in the world. And the reason he was visiting there, trains from that port make a 6,800-mile journey three times a week, delivering goods back and forth between Germany and China. And they hope to, you know, that was once a week a couple of years ago. Now it's three times a week, and they hope to raise it to seven times a week, once a day. And a lot of growth is dependent on these trains, and these trains are controlled by Russian railways in conjunction with German railways. So, I mean, Russia is already a critical cog in the whole German economy. We don't know this. I mean, we're not conscious of this. I mean, you know, it was almost laughable to hear Merkel rebuke Putin. I mean, there's absolutely nothing she can do about it. Nothing. I mean, these alliances are coming together right in front of our noses, and we're just sort of like shrugging our shoulders.
Dr. Lieb, we appreciate that massive database you call a brain. I'm going to look forward to having you back on the show. Hope that you're feeling better, and very kind of you to take time from your busy schedule for us today.
No, appreciate it, Chris. I always do. I always like talking to you. Okay, bye-bye.